5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Well, thanks so much for tuning in to Talking Point. I'm your host, Neeraj Shah. It's very interesting and to see how the auto industries come back. And despite the lockdowns emanating in almost all of the European region and some parts of India now starting to see that, the outlook for the auto industry in the current times becomes even more important. And the fact that companies are announcing CapEx plans is testimony to the belief that the growth trajectory is here to stay. Minda Industries is no different. Their board has approved the expansion plans in the four-wheeler lighting and four-wheeler alloy wheel segments. In fact, as I read, the Balwal plant capacity, the board has approved an expansion of almost 50% from 1.2 lakh wheels per month to 1.8 lakh wheels per month. Sunil Bora joins in right now to talk about how they believe the current business atmosphere is and what is in store for FY22 at the start of the year. Sunil, so good having you. Thanks for joining in. Hope all is safe.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, all well. Thanks, Neeraj.
Sunil, so tell us, you guys have announced capacity expansion plans. There are a lot of triggers which analysts and the investor community believes are in store for your company because of various initiatives by the government. How is the business momentum currently looking like?
Yeah. So, Neeraj, we all know the post-impact of COVID, the things have definitely improved a lot. We have seen month-on-month improvement in the volumes where October was almost the peak. Unfortunately, we have not seen those kind of numbers again, but no complaint because it's a seasonal impact. Every year, that's a normal cycle. October, normally you see a peak. Diwali season is normally the best month of the year. Having said that, if we see post Diwali, I think things have been pretty stable. Yes, they are not the way obviously you wish to, but I don't have any reason to complain because A, the things are definitely looking better, or I would say stable. And we are actually today having numbers. If you see January, February, March numbers will come out today, tomorrow. They are definitely better than what they were pre-COVID numbers, right? So from that perspective, definitely things have been much better. Yes, there have been some tailwinds, I would say, of the sheer personal mobility, which has been triggered because of COVID, people trying to avoid the shared commutation or shared transport. So that is also giving some bump up to the demand. And also for last 2-3 years, we all know that the markets have not been so rewarding for the sector. Volumes have been coming down year on year. And there has been a lot of demand which was held back, maybe because of the pricing pressures, the cost increases, or the confusion in the mind of people because of transition from BS4 to BS6, or when EV will come, what will be the shape of size of the EV, how cost of the EV will play out. So a lot of people were actually deferring their purchases, right? So that demand which was withheld also is gradually, we believe, is coming to the market. And that is what is giving some stability in the volumes. Now, if someone asks how this market you expect going to be in forward, it's a very tricky question, if I may say, as you said, because you're talking of demand, I'm preempting it and trying to answer that. It's as good as like shooting in the dark, because no one has seen this pandemic in our lifetime before, right? But the way things are and the way things have been in past few months, that gives some comfort that demand is here to stay. Now, how much that is going to improve, it's like anybody's guess. So, and if we see some of the businesses which you have just stated, the board has approved the expansion plans. Businesses have actually been operating almost close to the near the capacity, or maybe a little beyond the capacity. So, which is a very, very good sign. And that may not necessarily be because of the demand per se, because there is also shift in what you call as premiumization. Like both alloy wheel and lighting are the big beneficiaries of premiumization, or the transition from, say, steel wheel to alloy wheel, or a normal lamp to an LED lamp. So they are also beneficiaries of that. So that may not necessarily give an indication that demand is like very, very up, because we are not seeing that kind of...
You mean general demand may not be as strong, but demand for your products yes. might be good.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Sunil, would you tell us which of your business segments what would be the current breakup between the business segments on the revenue front, say end of FY21, assuming some numbers for the last quarter, and how would that shape up going ahead? Because I hear from so many quarters about the segments that you are in and the fact that the airbags being made mandatory as well also adds a bit of a kicker. So can you just break it down for us?
Yeah. So if you see from our segment perspective, first of all, if I had to start with what we spoke about, airbags, right? So airbags, we have a joint venture with a partner, Japanese partner called TG, Toyota Gosei, which is a Toyota group company. And from that perspective, if I see, this is a joint venture and it is a 50-50 JV. Now, because it is a 50-50 JV, right? As per the new Ind AS accounting norms, that revenue does not get consolidated into Minda financials. So even though the business will grow, you don't see that growth coming into the, reflecting into the financials.
Okay.
Now, if I have to see the, in terms of top line, yes, it does have a benefit in terms of the share of profit of joint ventures, etc. So that definitely is coming as a benefit. But if I have to exclude that, if I see all the businesses which get consolidated into Minda Industries, switches is one of our biggest segment which gets consolidated. It's almost one third of our top line. When I say switches, it's both two wheeler and four wheeler put together. So switches is roughly a third of our total top line, followed by lighting, both two wheelers and PVs. So that's almost a quarter. So that's around 24-25% of our top line. Then the other is acoustics, which is in a layman's, if you call a horn or something like that. So horn, we have India in India business, plus we have a subsidiary in Spain under name called Platon. So that put together is almost like 14-15% of our revenue. And followed by the light metal division, which is primarily the casting business and the alloy wheels, etc., which is around a similar number, around 14-15% of our top line. And balance, we have some of the businesses which are the future high growth businesses, like sensors, like blow molding, like controllers. So they are all part of others. So that is how the revenue split broadly is.
Okay. Now, Sunil, I may be presumptive here, but India's love affair with the technological prowess of Indian auto ancillaries kind of took shape and form with Motherson Sumi's wiring harness business, right? When people realized that auto ancillary companies are not just back-end manufacturers, suppliers to OEMs, but have technological prowess, which are big moats around their business. As you look at both the current set of products that you have and the future growth drivers, some of which sensors, for example, might be deeply technological products and therefore high barriers to entry once you make an inroad into a client's book. How do you foresee the next 5 years? Because one, you might be as large global suppliers or ambitions to be as large global suppliers as domestic. And two, the various other products that you spoke about might grow eventually in size, even as the other products are growing. So how do you see that shaping up over the course of the next 5 years?
Yeah. So first of all, definitely technology, Neeraj, plays a very, very big role. And if I see from that perspective, and if you see from first Uno Minda perspective, our engineering and R&D spend is almost 6.5% of our top line, which is as big as you see in the sector, right? Yes. And this is something which gives you an edge over others. So we are not just like a manufacturing or outsourced manufacturing company. A lot of products you see are home developed, home grown. If I have to give an example, right? And yes, sensor is a high-end product. But that's maybe more from a layman's terminology. But if you see even switches, even lighting, there is a lot of technology at play. I'll give one example. Like in switch, we have home developed something called a side stand switch, right? Now to explain a little better, if you ride a bike, normally you see accidents happening where people forget to put up the side stand, right? And just start riding the bike and then on the turn you slip and have an accident. So we had developed in-house almost 5 years back, 4 or 5 years back, something called a side stand switch. So unless you put the stand up, the bike will not run. Now that has just now, after 4 years of development, has seen some acceptance from the OEMs because it also has a price point, right? Wow. So now you will see some of the models which are coming in gradually from a couple of OEMs. You will see that side stand switch being, product being given as a feature, right? Well, it's not a necessity. It's a feature now being added. And gradually you will see that added now. That product was patented by us almost 4 or 5 years back. So any new business, we expect that to come to us. Same way, if I see, same way in the two-wheeler itself, we have today developed something called a touch-based Bluetooth-enabled small LED panel which comes on your bike, where you can, while riding, take your calls, accept, whatever, operate the phone in the pocket. Now, when do you see that practical application? Time will only tell, because it also has again a price point. Same way in car switches. Today you have lever-based switches. The world gradually is going to go to a touch-based. We are already having some protos, etc., developed from that perspective. Now, when you see the production, time will only tell, because again, it has a cost advantage, cost delta. Same way lighting, you are moving from halogen to an LED. The cost delta is 2.5 times, right? It is not that India can't manufacture LED, but then a 2,000 rupee lamp in a car going to a 7,000 to 8,000 rupee lamp, it has a big price delta. So there are technology play in every product, and we are focusing a lot on R&D, and we firmly believe that if we are able to provide a product which is ahead of time to the customers, we are always there to gain business. Now, you ask me what is the road ahead for 4 or 5 years? Our focus always is that how do we continuously increase the kit value of the products we supply, right? Mm-hmm. There are multi-faceted areas where you can grow. You can grow horizontally by adding newer products. You can grow vertically by adding more features to your products. So our focus of late has been more grow vertically than horizontally. We already have 30 businesses, which is very huge for a auto system supplier company, right? So our focus or endeavor today is how do we grow vertically? How do we increase our kit value? So today, if I'm giving X value of the switches or a lamp into a car, how do I increase that value by giving more and more features, more and more value addition to the product? So that helps me outperform the industry growth. Second, how do I increase my size of the cake itself? So if the industry size, say for example, switches is 100, I'm already at 50 or 60% of the market share. Now to grow from here, it needs definitely a different thought process. So that is the another area. The last which we are currently consistently working and fortunately very successful is going globally and actually to the market, we are already there. We are there in ASEAN for more than 10, 12 years. In Indonesia and Vietnam, we have manufacturing facilities. We are there in Spain and Germany. Spain, we have manufacturing facility. We acquired a company called Klarten in 2013. We have acquired two companies in Germany. They are there almost like 2.5 years now, 3 years now. We have a manufacturing facility in Mexico and Colombia. So our endeavor is, today we are there globally with some of the large known names, but maybe limited number of components. Now our endeavor is, how do I give more product features? To give those customers. So export is another area to grow.
Are you seeing success there, increasing the wallet share within some of the large customers?
Yes, definitely. So it's happening both ways. It's happening domestically also and globally also. If you see that recently, we have bagged businesses for exports for switches. We are exporting to Hyundai, we are exporting to Pirelli, we are exporting to a lot of global suppliers. And we are currently working with one of the large OEM in the two-wheeler space for some new business, which is going to be sizable and also establish us in the top league globally. So that we are pretty confident that in another couple of months, we should have that order in our hand. Once it is there, I'm sure we'll be able to announce the name. But the point I'm trying to say is that we are there from technology perspective at the top. And annually, we file a number of patents in our switches business in India. So everything is homegrown and it's our mother bread and butter businesses. From that perspective, I think we are pretty confident to increase our wallet share even globally.
Okay. This announcement of CapEx, is it a factor of you already being at high capacity utilization levels and more queries coming in because of which you had to do this? Or is this slightly ahead of time because you are preempting what could happen 12 months out?
Actually, it is not preempting, Neeraj. We actually have secured businesses,
of course,
which we have to deliver from next year onwards. Now, in say a wheel business, I'm already running at capacity. And normally in the industry, auto supplier, auto systems or ancillary, there is expectation that you at least have 10 to 15% spare capacity available. So that in case there is any sudden demand jump, right, you are able to meet that demand. Because earlier the days were a customer or an OEM, for one component, he would give business to maybe two people, right? But that means double designing cost, double tooling cost, double engineering cost. So now gradually what's happening is market has shifted to only one supplier, one component. So if I am supplying a lamp for a car, I'm the only supplier. Now, if I don't have capacity and the customer wants to grow, how do you do that? So that way, A, you need to have some buffer demand. B, we have actually got some good businesses for both the products which you have announced, for four-wheeler and two-wheeler. In fact, from four-wheeler lighting perspective, if I may say so, we currently have three manufacturing plants. And our annual revenue is something around 400 to 450 crores. And the new business which we have got, which we have to start supplying from next year, is almost 200 crores. And it's almost impossible to supply that kind of value from your existing plants. And that's why there is a need to set up this new plant. Same way for alloy wheel, the new businesses which you have secured, you have to have additional capacity to meet those demand, plus maybe some additional margin available for that 10% to 15% flexibility.
Got it. Okay. Now, before I come to numbers, just a couple of other key questions. One is this whole conversation around rising commodity costs and the impact that it has. For auto OEMs, the impact would be severe, and I think they've had to take some price hikes. The belief is that for most of high quality suppliers, maybe like you, it's a simple pass through, and therefore it will not impact margins. Would that be a safe assumption?
Yes and no. Now, yes and no in a way. Yes, there definitely is an annual price discussion or price settlement clause where the commodity price up or down, even if it goes down, then also I have to adjust it. So that is there. So that definitely supports. No, in a way, because business to business or OEM to OEM, there is different policy. Somewhere the price adjustment is on a quarterly basis, somewhere it is on annual basis. I think it's fortunate that the price hike is at such a time where the annual discussion is now going to start. So from that specific point, it helps. But if you see from the Q4 perspective, definitely it will impact negatively.
Okay. Yeah. That's what I was actually trying to get to, that Q4, you would believe that most people, and maybe you in particular, will see some impact of the commodity cost inflation?
Definitely there will be, because as I said, the areas where your price adjustments on an annual basis and price increase started from September, October, that will hit negatively.
Okay. The other question is this whole buzzword around EVs, right? Now, as much as we may like to scoff at it, I think we're seeing telltale signs of people recognizing that plans, for example, announced by Ola Electric are making large brokerages nervous about the incumbents' bread and butter businesses as well. So my question to you is, where within this supply chain ecosystem on EVs and particularly electric two-wheelers, because they seem to be getting adoption faster in India, are you, and how can you increase your penetration and size there from where you are right now, wherever you are?
Absolutely, Neeraj. So I'll split this point into maybe answer into two parts. One is all our existing businesses and the opportunity for EVs. If you see all our existing businesses, barring the filter business or maybe the CNG business, almost every other business is agnostic to the type of energy you run your vehicle on. Maybe it's seats or horns or lamps or wheels. You need EV or non-EV, right? So from that perspective, it actually insulates the Minda Group from the vulnerability of future. We are into a business which will maybe taper down, you know, maybe 10 to 15 year type of scenario. So from that point, we are well placed. From EV perspective, actually, it's an opportunity the way we see it, because it gives you a platform, a Minda platform, to get into newer components, which are maybe more EV specific, and you may not necessarily see a growth in maybe a year or two or three, but definitely once the EV picks up, you are there in the race, and actually you stand to gain more than anybody else, because we already have the relationship or the business with almost every OEM in the country, right? So, and even the new entrants like EV, I can't take the specific names, but we are there working and in discussion with almost all of them, right? So that also helps you get into not only your existing products, but also EV specific. We are already supplying some of the EV specific products to one of the OEMs, which are already in production or in supply. I can take the name because no, it's for Bajaj. If you see Bajaj E-Chetak, we are supplying smart plugs, we are supplying a couple of other EV components. On top of it, we have our horns, we have our lamps, we have our switches. They are also there in that vehicle. So from that perspective, we are already there in the EV. We are also working more towards EV components. And the if I have to quantify the opportunity value, right? We are looking at something more than 4,000 to 8,000 rupees per vehicle from two-wheeler to three-wheeler vehicle in terms of the kit value, additional kit value. Now, how much pie you get of the cake is a different point. But in terms of new products, we are already there. We are working very aggressively in-house. And also, we have done a small technology tie-up with a company called AMP of US, who works with people like Tesla and all, for filling the any technology piece where the time taken to develop gets shortened. So if you do yourself, obviously you take a little more time, but if you can do some TLA or technology licensing with somebody who has already developed, it shortens your product lifecycle time. So from that perspective also, we are looking at a lot of things to see how do we shorten this cycle of new product development. So we are there, and we see EV more as an opportunity to outperform and continue on this journey.
One final question, and I understand that you'll be in a constraint to talk about quarter four specifically, so I won't ask you about that. But can you tell us if you believe that the kind of growth run rate that you've shown in the last, let's say, 5 years, a CAGR numbers, what have you, at this kind of a base, but with the kind of opportunity, so there is a high base, yes, but the opportunity is probably higher with EVs and all the other products coming on stream. Do you reckon the CAGR run rate can be replicated or improved upon over the course of the next 5 years?
Yeah. So Neeraj, look, from CAGR perspective, our destiny is linked to the eventual market demand.
Of course.
If market demand is not there, definitely you can't grow. Where there is a direct correlation. But our endeavor always has been, if market grows X, how do we grow 1.5X? Right? And I'm pretty confident for next 5 to 10 years, we should be able to deliver on that aspect. If market grows X, we grow much more than X. Even if you see the previous quarters or previous years, we have been consistently outperforming market on an average by 8 to 10% or maybe more in some years, right? Why and how? We just spoke about maybe higher kit value, higher wallet share, new products, higher technological advantage. So all these things helps together, and I'm pretty confident that we should be able to deliver on that aspect. If market grows 7%, how do we grow 10%, 12% or 15%? So that has been our endeavor, to have this delta growth versus the industry growth. And I'm pretty confident, based on the product profile we already have, the product life cycle we already have, the some of the new capexes which we are doing, that will give the visibility for at least 5 to 7 years. We will be able to continuously do maybe more than that.
Sunil ji, wish you all the best, and we look forward to talking to you post your quarterly numbers. Thank you so much for speaking to us today.
Thank you.
Thank you. And viewers, thanks for tuning into this edition of The Talking Point.